The Board of Education meeting now comes to order. My apologies for us starting a little late this morning. Please rise for the invocation. O God, we pray to administer that which is just in all educational policies, being ever mindful of your guidance, stir us to action with love, wisdom, and understanding.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Welcome to the meeting of the Board of Education. This meeting is being televised live on AACPS-TV and live streamed on the internet. General information and protocols for the meeting are posted on the sign by the doorway as you enter the room, so please make sure you read those if you have not already. Mr. Grannon and Mr. Reinhart are not able to be here this morning. Item 2.03 is approval of the minutes.
So moved.
Second.
So any discussion? All right, all those in favor? Okay, motion passes. How many do we have? Six? 6-0. All right, item 2.04, Mr. Gilliland.
Thank you, Madam President. I move to add to the agenda item 5.00, 2017-18 Board of Education meeting dates.
I second.
Okay. Item 2.05 is recognitions, and there are none today. Item 2.06, Ms. Sasso.
Today, we recognize a true professional who plays a vital role in our school system, serving as a link between students, parents, staff, and the community. She provides a valuable service to students who are struggling with academic success and overall well-being, and to teachers who benefit from her guidance in working with their students. Claudette Robinson Blackwell, social worker at MacArthur Middle School, demonstrates a high degree of professionalism in her daily interactions with all those who live she touches. Claudette consistently maintains a professional and positive approach while helping other staff members focus on positive aspects and solutions for students. She's a leader on her trauma team responses, modeling for others how to respond in a calm and supportive way, even in a crisis situation. Claudette is a skilled communicator. Because of her ways in connecting and working effectively with staff, Claudette was chosen from among nearly 100 psychologists and social workers to be a crisis prevention training for our county. Furthermore, her department chair at MacArthur notes that Claudette is the first person that she wants to have with her when there is a difficult parent or student meeting. Claudette's work is as effective with students as it is with adults, providing counseling and trauma support to schools where they have experienced a student death or other tragedy. She uses intervention method to de-escalate children, reduce aggression and violence, and maintain safety of the crisis student and others. She also conducts both individual and group counseling with students, working on such topics as anger management, social skills, and improving behavior. Claudette is an active member of school teams that are focused on promoting positive changes and growth, including the PBIS team, the behavior support team, and the student support team. She's also a member of the Kindness Committee in support of the superintendent's Be Nice campaign. Claudette is continuously taking a new volunteer and charitable projects such Harvest for the Hungry, Backpack Buddies, and the Gloves and Hats campaign. She also serves as her school volunteer coordinator, soliciting parent volunteers and spend time screening and training them. Claudette Robinson Blackwell, you play an integral role in promoting the health and welfare of the MacArthur Middle School family. Your interpersonal and professional skills make you a great communicator, and as a member of a select group of highly qualified professionals chosen to train other staff countywide in these techniques, are of the many reasons you have been chosen Educator of the Month for December 2017. The board commends you and thanks you for all you do for Anne Arundel County Public Schools. Congratulations.
Supervisor about the works that are in place in my building. So you got me, Mr. Whitey. So I'm here, and I want to thank my family for being here, and I want to give honor to God for such an honor. I don't consider this work. This is just what I do. I'm very passionate about the work that I do for the students and families, and I thank you all for seeing the talents in me. I come to work ready to go every day. I have a lot of time to think about what I'm going to do in my 45-minute commute to work every day. And it's with great joy that I bring to the job every day. So it's truly an honor and a gift to receive this. I thank you. first, I want to start with...
Okay, she can't remember your name.
It's, whew, let me try and connect you all. It's all about connections, right? So we tell our students how we persevere and build character and grit. So a little bit about my own personal story and how I'm standing before you today. My journey to Maryland began in 1981 when I lost my own mother to breast cancer. So my beautiful sister took on the reins of raising me and to the woman that you see before me. And you know that you can't do that without a strong man that stands beside you. So I had the privilege of being raised by a man of great character, no nonsense, go to school, get your grades, and bring home an attitude of gratitude. And they're both here today. So Matt McMillan, please stand. And my sister Gwen McMillan. So they raised me. And my wonderful husband, who is always keeping me grounded and focused, and he's responsible for my nice outfit. But really, he is like the backbone of what I do to kind of push and pull, and we just got married 2 years ago, so we're still like, you new baby. Shelton Blackwell is here along with my great honor and privilege to have my mother-in-law, Alice Blackwell. Always keeping me inspired and prayed up as I go into the buildings and in the community. So thank you all for being here today. And Mr. Whiting is here. He is going nonstop in the building, buzzing here, buzzing there, buzzing everywhere, as you all know. And he's here. I guess he's a part of this great honor. Knows the work that goes into running the building and seeing that the students, families, and staff are attended to. So I just want to thank you for all that you all see in me every day. My family, staff members, team members, thank you all so much. Well, I appreciate it.
We would like to present you with this certificate.
Thank you.
And a bell with your name so that you can use it when it's necessary. At the intermission, we'll be taking pictures with you and all your family too, so don't leave.
Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right. Item 2.07 is Employee of the Month, and who has the, oh, Mr. Gilliland.
Thank you, Madam President. Today we recognize an employee in our school system whose work ethic reminds us of the song, No One Does It Better. Because frankly, no one does his job better than James Selman, custodian at Corcoran Middle School. Mr. Selman begins each day at 6 a.m., placing cones out on the parking lot to assist with traffic, rain or shine. He then thoroughly goes through the building, making sure everything is ready for a smooth school day for both teachers and students. Whenever there is a problem that needs his attention, James always goes above and beyond to get the problem resolved. He takes pride in his work, knowing that the appearance of the school is his responsibility. James is unfailingly courteous and professional to everyone with whom he interacts. He strives for excellence in all tasks, big and small, and keeps working until things are completed to perfection. James follows through on all requests, no matter how trivial they might seem, and responds to anything asked of him with willingness and maximum effort. He exemplifies the high standard of customer service that AACPS asks of its employees and always sets a positive professional tone in his interactions with others. Mr. Selman's contributions to the positive environment at Corcoran don't stop with his meticulous care of the facility. He interacts with students in a number of ways. He is an amazing role model and mentor for the students at Corcoran. One can hear him every day telling students to do their best and stay positive. And a strong piece of advice he gives to students are your actions are how others perceive you. Administrators at the school have told us that some students say that they are trying to do better in school because of Mr. Selman. James Selman, you are a perfect example of whatever it takes approach that helps make Corcoran a safe, supportive, positive environment for students, staff, and families. If anyone were to receive an award for a positive attitude, it would be you. Your constant smile, positive attitude, and happy demeanor are contagious. The Corcoran family feels lucky to have you on its team. So on behalf of the Board of Education, the students, teachers, and staff of the Anne Arundel County Public Schools, we are pleased to recognize you as the Employee of the Month for December 2017. Congratulations.
Yes.
I owe a lot of them. Diane, where you?
What did you believe you were here for today?
To move furniture.
None of that today. So no backbreaking work today, I hope. We saw a few people came in, if you'd like to introduce them.
This is my wife in the back, Roslyn Selman. It all started from the great tutoring of Diane Hall.
We do have a citation for you. There's the speech I just gave that's there for you as well. And the bell is engraved. So you can ring it, hit anybody with it, whatever you need to do. It's there for you. And we'll take a picture in a few minutes.
Thank you all very
much.
Congratulations. All right, thank you.
All right. Item 2.08 is Volunteer of the Month, Ms. Cole.
Throughout AACPS, all of our schools are fortunate to have members of their community who devote their time to our students. But some schools are truly privileged to have a volunteer that continuously exceeds all our expectations. Our December Volunteer of the Month has engaged all aspects of Sunset Elementary School and has successfully welcomed and encouraged other parents to become involved in school as well. This effort has significantly increased staff and community involvement in the school. This month, the board is honored to recognize Ms. Erin Bell, PTA president and devoted member of Sunset Elementary Community, as Volunteer of the Month. As Laura Espinoza, assistant principal, stated, Mrs. Bell has been an asset to Sunset Elementary School and since her child enrolled. She has jumped into supporting our parents, teachers, and students by serving as an officer on the PTA board, first as vice president and currently as president. Mrs. Bell works tirelessly to ensure that families and members of Sunset Elementary Community are involved with the ongoings of the school through a monthly newsletter, as well as a newly remodeled social media page. As Ms. Candida St. John said, Erin's enthusiasm for the entire school community is evident. She works hard to achieve the mission and vision of Sunset Elementary and AACPS. Ms. Bell also strives to communicate effectively and be a positive role model to all in the community. Mrs. Bell embodies teamwork and commitment to the school community, says Tony Carr, school principal. Ms. Carr also says that Mrs. Bell has been actively involved in planning and providing innovative programs and activities for the entire school community. She has successfully organized a variety of PTA events to increase active family involvement at our school. Notably, she is a high supporter of teachers and staff at our school and recognizes their dedication in the education of students. One example that is truly outstanding is the father-daughter dance that was held this winter for the first time at Sunset Elementary. From the red carpet at the front door, flowers for each of the girls, and fairy tale decoration, Mrs. Bell led a team of volunteers to bring her vision to life. The event was such a success that even the DJ posted about it on social media, saying that no other gig could compare to it, and expressed that he was humbled and proud to be a part of it. As Ms. Espinoza said, Ms. Bell has set a vision of partnership between the community and school, and through her positive and kind words and effective actions, has built confidence in our school community and has been a catalyst to increase parent participation as well as staff involvement. Ms. Bell, thank you for your exemplary volunteer work to benefit the students, staff, and family of Sunset Elementary School. Would you please come forward? And with great appreciation, I would like to present you with a volunteer certificate and bell to you. Item 2.09 is School and Community Highlights. Ms. Korbelak.
Say again. Mrs. Hummer and Ms. Nally and I had the opportunity to go visit the International Education or Welcome Center located at the Phoenix Academy about a week ago. Mm-hmm. And we were just so impressed by the staff, and the lobby was full of folks who had been displaced from Hurricane Maria, and they were coming in and getting welcomed and situated here at AACPS. We're just grateful that we have that center available now.
Mr. Gilliland.
Thank you again, Madam President. I would just like to say I had the privilege of visiting the Fall Student Artwork Exhibition, which was held at the Maryland House of Delegates building this past Monday. I could not stay for the entire event, but I was able to tour the gallery that they had staged at the start of the event. And the winner of the event was Elizabeth Kiley of Sverna Park High School, and her piece was called Gramps, which I thought was just amazing. But it really was a testament to the great creativity of our students statewide, and you know, certainly very special for AACPS to have one of its own win the state award and be presented by First Lady Yumi Hogan.
Ms. Nally.
Early this morning, I attended the Scholarship for Scholars meeting, and this group, Board of Trustees, was established many, many years ago by former Superintendent Dr. Ed Anderson to use the ESCHEAT funds that can come to us through the state. And over the years, the group has provided over in excess of $3 million in scholarships to Anne Arundel County public and private students, and so it has really made a huge difference for our students. Debbie Hardy, who is the executive assistant, announced her resignation this morning. She's been working with Scholarship for Scholars for 17 years, and she will, as Greg Stuyvesant, one of the Board of Trustees members, said, she will be very difficult, if not impossible, to replace. I also want to thank the Board of Trustees, this volunteer group, and I want to commend South River High School, as from all the high schools who had the most applicants for scholarships. They had over 76 applicants in 2017, and 57 received scholarships. So this is a commendation for the counselors and the people who really let the students know. I know the Board of Trustees goes out, and I want to, you know, encourage all guidance counselors in their schools to let the students know, get this information out, because these scholarships are invaluable. There's one worth $6,000, which was the Ed Anderson Scholarship. So they are excellent, wonderful scholarships. I also want to commend Anne Arundel County retired school personnel. Each year they give $12,000 to this organization to provide scholarships for students who are pursuing a degree in education. And I think this is a remarkable way that our retired teachers, they do a lot, and that people don't even realize. I'm one, so I know what they do. But anyway, but they do a lot. But this is one thing that I don't think is really, maybe people don't know about, but they do provide these scholarships for these worthy students. So thank you very much, Scholarship for Scholars, for all that you do. And thank you to the guidance counselors for making sure that the students are aware of this opportunities.
Thank you. I want to echo what Mr. Gilliland said. We're talking about the great creativity and talent of our students in the county. This past weekend, I had the pleasure of attending an original play at Annapolis High School, Lost in Narnia. This was a play written by a student, directed by a student. Everything was student run, and very ambitious, and it really was a great opportunity for the kids and a really fine result for it. So really enjoyed that, and I know all of our schools across the county just do amazing drama and artwork. And so as we get into play season and concert season, I encourage everyone to go to your local school and check it out, even beginning strings concerts, because someday they will be seniors and they will sound better. So item 2.10 is the CAC report.
Good morning, Melanie Teichert, Chair of the CAC. We continue to meet the second Monday of each month, 7 to 9 p.m. here in the boardroom. Like last year, we won't meet in December because of the busyness of the month and to let our subcommittees get started. So our next meeting will be Monday, 8 January. We will have Matt Stansky, I saw him over there, present the budget to us, which is just in time for the public hearings and workshops, so that's good timing to have that in January. He's been gracious enough to do that the last few years, and it's really one of our favorite meetings of the year. I feel like we learned so much at that budget meeting, so thank you for your willingness to do that. We also appreciate Dr. Arlotto's visit in October, where he presented the strategic plan to us, which, of course, is before the board today. We've got a really great committee this year. Those board members that have made it to meetings have seen we have really engaged members. They're eager to disseminate information on behalf of the board and the county and to filter feedback back. In an effort to help get the word out, next week, Kelly Purnell, our vice chair, and I will be doing a Parent Connect cable TV interview with Teresa Tudor. So we'll be filming that, and I don't know exactly when it will be coming out, but watch for that. So we hope to get some information out about the CAC that way as well. Common issues we've heard about this year won't be a surprise to anyone in this room. We do still continue to hear about the school calendar and school hours. Overcrowding in schools is a hot topic now. Social and emotional wellness of students. I'll get to more of that in a minute, but it was really great to see one of our social workers be recognized this morning. That's addressing some of the things that we're hearing about. And then transportation. We do appreciate the board and the staff's willingness to work with us on answering questions. So as you know, we have sent specific questions both to people in the staff and the board and have gotten very helpful answers that we've been able to get back to the community, and we appreciate that. As you'll see from the list of subcommittees, some of these are things that we will work on. So we have finalized our committees for the year. Just just last week, we have populated all of those, and there are five. The first one is a continuing committee from last year that has been renamed slightly with a focus partially based on the strategic plan and conversation with Dr. Alotto that we are focusing on social emotional wellness of students. So we have a core of committee members that are experts in mental health, life skills preparations, high-risk student populations, and so we're hoping to learn more about the services provided by the school to help get the word out to the community about those programs, to identify cluster-specific best practices so that we can share those with other clusters, and then perhaps identify any gaps if they exist in services. So to that end, we did have the Director of Student Services, who I see back there. He came out to our November meeting, which was really helpful to educate all of our committee and to help that subcommittee get started. Our second committee is focused on, we don't really quite know what to name it, but school overcrowding and community development relationships. So both of our, Mr. Gilliland and Mrs. Hummer, when you came, that was an area of interest. As all of us know, we have many new students, and having the staff to follow has been a challenge for multiple reasons. So the board and staff have helped us already to learn about how the community development process in the county has allowed an increase in student populations that's contributed to overcrowding in some areas. So what our committee wants to do is to help educate the community about how that happens with respect to community development, and then advocate for the school system as appropriate to ameliorate those impacts. Related to that, our third committee is a little bit broader. Is based on advocacy in general, so related to school overcrowding, but a little bit broader. We have many members who are just really eager to work with our community to advocate for our schools, and so we're trying to figure out ways to do that. We're aware that by CAC policy, we are limited in how we can lobby on issues, and we'll work carefully with Teresa and the board to make sure we follow all of those policy guidelines. And the vision isn't to lobby per se, but to really mobilize community stakeholders to help advocate for our schools. That's really the vision of that committee. And then our last two, the fourth one is on college and career readiness, really focusing on the great programs that exist throughout our county already and to help disseminate those best practices. In our experience with the CAC, we'll find one high school cluster does some really neat things with respect to college and career readiness, and we're just hoping to maybe collate those and help get the word out and use the resources already provided by the school system and make sure that those are that word about those are getting out. And then finally, we have a longstanding committee on equity. We will continue that work. The focus isn't set specifically yet. They will get with the equity office, which has had some changes over the last few months in personnel. We want to make sure that our focus is in line with that office and with the board as well. So we definitely would appreciate input on items of interest from the board as well. So our committee work is just getting started. Like I said, we just finalized those on 1 December, so we'll be getting started on that and then look forward to updating you in the coming months on what we find. Thank you.
Thank you. Item 2.11 is the PTA report.
Hello. Wow, I was also in shock. Congratulations, Ms. Bell. Thank you for making the PTA what it is. I hope people will follow your lead and that you will be a great example. And I would love to talk to you about maybe, you know, joining us here at the AAC PTA. You know, we always need great leaders like you to continue to promote the PTAs. As you can see, it's a great addition to the schools. So thank you very much. I'm so happy I was here this morning. Woo. Okay, so that makes me my leeway even easier. So audits are done. Woohoo! Every school, if they still need any help, we are here to help. Just send us an email and we'll respond as soon as possible. We also encourage all PTAs to please file with the IRS, as we want to continue to maintain their status. We don't want to lose that. Please reach out. I try my best to answer all emails as fast as I can. And if not, we do have a meeting next Tuesday here at this building at 5:30. And I will be here even if nobody else shows up. And if you need any help, I can help you out. Also, the Maryland PTA is very gracious, has been having a lot of trainings for our treasurers, audits, treasurers. So we do have one tonight, and it's a webinar, so you can be in your PJs, and one on the 14th. So no excuse to my treasurers and PTAs who are listening to please take it seriously, because we do benefit a lot as a school having PTAs, as our example, Ms. Bell. And, of course, other schools that I am very proud of listening and hearing and seeing on their Twitter pages and Facebook, the wonderful work they do for our children every day. So I encourage them to continue to do that, and that they know that I am very grateful to be up here representing them. So thank you very much. That's all my updates.
Thank you. Okay, we're now going to take a short break so that we can have photos taken with our employee, volunteer, and educators of the month. So if all those folks would head to the lobby, and we'll be back here in about 10 minutes. Thank you.
Okay, we're going to start back up. Is it not on? Can you hear me now? Nope. Oh, there we go. Thank you, Ms. Howell. All right. We will now move on to public comment. Anyone wishing to speak on an item not on today's agenda may offer testimony during this public comment portion of the meeting. Speakers are allotted 3 minutes each and may not allocate their time to others. A tone will sound when time has expired. The board asks that comments remain civil and appropriate for the various audiences that may be watching or viewing this meeting. Student-specific and personnel matters are confidential and cannot be discussed in this forum. It is not the board's general practice to engage in question and answer session with speakers. For the record, please give your name before speaking, and handouts should be given to the board assistant. So first, Tracy Henderson, Jimmy Arbogast, Janet Taff, and that will be the first batch.
Good morning. Thank you for welcome. My name is Tracy Henderson. I'm a parent and mother of Jones Elementary School. I have a question, you know, concerned of students within the school district for the state of Maryland. Okay. Number one is for the student testing. We as parents do not know what's covered on the test, what's coming home from school. Okay. Lately, I have noticed that my son, you know, came home from school, you know, and the test was kind of confused for the math, you know, math course. And I know for a fact that, okay, the Department of Education has changed the grade. That's confused the parents, okay? Right now, I want to know the scale. I have noticed that it was 59% in the reading, 59% in the math and science and history, okay? I know that this district has tried to improve the education for these kids, and I feel like, okay, we as parents, yes, it started at home, and when they're in school, it's a different step. I noticed that, you know, a lot of changes as far as the testing goes. We as parents do not know what's covered on the test, okay? And the test is now confusing the kids because if they're going to learn a new way of math, we want to know the formula, the new way of math, and how we can work with our children at home to teach them without the children coming home with the, like I say, the study guide, the review for the study for the test. Some of the teachers are not giving the students that information to bring home. This is why I'm addressing the board, because something needs to be changed, okay? Now, I know that the old grade scales, like A, is, okay, A is 199, A, or not A to start on, is B, you know, B. Okay, if they're going to do the grade that way, we would like to know that way, okay? With them changing and telling us the other way, it's confusing. We want to know whether our child improving in reading and math and where they, you know, address. You know, I want to address that option to me. That's why I'm here, you know, because without me not knowing what's covered on the test, just like, for example, the teacher gave the kids the testing. This comes from the Department of Education, where they had to stuck an answer on the sheet. Okay, now, the question is, some of the answers to the question is not related to the question. It's been error. And I feel that something needs to be done, something needs to be fixed. You know, something need to be fixed on that. They need to do something about that. Because I noticed that in the textbook that my child had brought home, and they had used, it, like, improper words. When I say improper words, okay, like, I'm American, okay? I'm African-American, okay? But they are using the wrong term on our history, okay? Like, they're saying that, they're trying to say that we are slaves, okay? I don't like the way they use it because it's not taught in school. Because it's right now it's no billing in school, you know. Because if they use that word like slave or use the N-word in school, what did they, I think them do it, you know, they're pushing the child to become a billing, you know. And
Ms. Henderson, I'm, thank you. The time's up. Dr. Arlotto.
I'm letting her translate. Ms. Henderson, thank you for coming in. Would you do me a favor and meet with our assistant superintendent for curriculum instruction so she can talk one-on-one with you about what your concerns are?
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, good morning, members of council. I'm Jim Arbogast. I think some of you already know me by now. I've been in the news a couple of times. I'm highlighting some incidents going on at Southern High School. I'm the father of a transgender student who was targeted earlier this month, actually last month, by a group of bullies calling themselves Confederate Lives Matter. While this may have been the highlight that made the news, I assure you this wasn't the first incident and certainly wasn't the last incident of bullying and targeting against transgender children in my school. I will admit that my initial knee-jerk reaction was to blame Southern High School, and looking at it now, I know that wasn't the case. Moving forward, I want to acknowledge first that some board members did actually email me and respond to my emails when I first brought up my concerns. I believe that the school board itself is the one who notified the police, and that's what started the initial investigation. I also want to highlight that I was contacted on the 30th of November by the regional superintendent for the Southern Cluster, to which I did reply, and I expressed some of my concerns about a change in policy. I've yet to hear from him. The Maryland Attorney General's Office for Civil Rights reached out to, again, the school board, the Maryland State School Board, and the regional and county school board, who in turn I did reach, was contacted by the Deputy Superintendent for Students yesterday afternoon, and she wants to set up a meeting to discuss changes at Southern High School. My goal is not to change Southern High School. I admit Southern High School is just one factor. Moving forward, I want to encourage the school system as a whole to set up a true policies, true guidelines that is universal throughout our school. I look at our school system. Arundel High School is probably a good example of a principal and the staff taking the lead, taking the reins on how to protect these transgender children. Mead High School is another good example. However, I believe the administration at both the middle and high school levels don't know how to treat transgenders because they don't have a clear guidance. They don't have their left and right boundaries. Realize the LGBT community, especially transgender community, transcend race, sex, religion, and even Republican, Democrat, whatever, they are out there. These kids are the silent ones that are going to school every day. They don't want to highlight themselves. They don't want to be targeted. They don't want to show that they were born one sex and they are definitely another sex. They want to go about their lives. However, they are day by day ever growing being targeted for hatred, for physical abuse, for physical violence, and in some cases rape. However, I believe the school systems and the schools themselves should be that safe, that neutral place for these kids to go educate themselves, go and do good things, and also be able to confide with their teachers and staff if there is something going on both at home, both in school, or both in the public. And I'm asking for change. There are two good support groups in this state, PFLAG of Maryland and GLSEN, that would be more than happy. They're both nonprofits that would be more than happy to come in here and help educate this board members and staff of the schools on how to treat and respect these transgender children. I'm not asking for big change. I'm certainly not asking you to accept my child and his decisions. But I'm asking you to protect the children and help educate these children.
Mr. Arbus, thank you for coming in. And I know that, as you said, you've met with school staff, and I know that you were recently, as early as yesterday, were in contact with our deputy superintendent, Mrs. Jackson. I know you're setting up a meeting. I don't know that you are aware that we were, if I'm not mistaken, the first school system in the state to develop guidelines to support transgender students. And those are guidelines that we say are dynamic, meaning we need to change them and improve them and get better as we learn more and better ways to support our students. So if you've not had a chance to review those, please do, and then you can help us provide, and certainly in the meeting, and I know that Mrs. Jackson asked you yesterday for specifics. What are some of those specific things that we can get better at, and not just supporting your son? I know you're advocating for all of our transgender students. So if you can help us with those specifics, those are dynamic. While they're written down and they're posted on our website, and we made them very public, and we started when we developed those guidelines, we started professional development for our teachers and administrators, and we're going to continue to do that, but they are dynamic. We need to learn more from students, from parents, from others. We've been in contact with a number of the other support groups, GLSEN and others, so that we can learn more and improve our guidelines. So I look forward to learning more about the conversation you have at the school with our deputy superintendent.
Thank you.
So thank you for your continued support.
Thank you.
Should I go ahead? Good morning. My name is Janet Taff. I have been a resident of Tracy's Landing for 30 years. I live in a tight-knit community with great neighbors who have children at Southern. My children are grown, and my daughter is a fourth-grade teacher in Chicago. She shares much information with me about anti-bullying, and I've been there and helped her set up her classroom, and signs are everywhere, and there's no tolerance for bullying. I am here to support the Arbogast family. I have not met them until today. Their son has been the victim of harassment and bullying at Southern. I know about this through the Capital newspaper. I have been in contact with Ms. Korbelak, who encouraged me to come and speak out if I felt comfortable. This is not my thing that I typically do, but I'm happy to be here and let you know that the community does care about this child and all children at Southern and other schools. Mrs. Korbelak told me about the investigation, but I do not fully understand the privacy laws protecting the perpetrators, but it appears there is silence as to the consequences of the actions towards the victim. If parents are to talk to their children at Southern, as suggested in the letter that was sent home after the article appeared in the paper, and I want to highlight that was after the article appeared in the paper, the parents were asked to talk to their children, and what do they tell their children at Southern? What are the consequences if something is done rather than just talking to them? They need to know what's going to happen if you do something, you bully, you spit on somebody, you disrespect them. My background is healthcare, specifically dental care, and I am big on prevention. What is being done to prevent future harassment such as the attack on Ryan Arbogast? Everyone should feel safe at school. And I hope that some of the things you're talking about, I learned a lot this morning about what has happened with the transgender situation. But what I'm looking at is more in the way of prevention, so this doesn't continue to happen, not just taking this one incident, but I certainly support them and their son totally. But I would like to know what's going on, and it seems that because of these privacy laws and rules that we don't get that information. I printed out this thing that's the policy from the Board of Education of Anne Arundel County about student records, and I had some questions when I looked at this because it's talking about, it reminds me of the HIPAA information I'm familiar with in healthcare that we all have to sign. But what this talks about in one, at one point under this section D, make available to parent, legal guardian, or eligible student, who would be Ryan, in conferences with appropriate school personnel, and it's to make these records available. So I don't know why the information is withheld. I know it has to do with the age and all that, and I certainly don't know the law about it, but I was just printing this out to familiarize myself with it. So I appreciate your time and all that you do. Thank you.
Dr. Arlotta.
Thank you, and thank you for supporting, being here and supporting the Arbogast. We have a student code of conduct, and maybe we can, that's posted on our website, maybe we can share that with you so that.
I did look
for okay,
that.
Perfect. All right, so you're well aware. So there are consequences. We don't identify students and consequences publicly. Those are things, those are private, like we would go, like we're looking to protect all of our students, both the victims and the perpetrators, and so that's not information, but there are consequences. The schools take those seriously in all cases, and follow the student code of conduct and contact the police when necessary.
Right. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Taff. All right, next group is Patricia Mathis, Priscilla Smith, Pilot Earl Smith, Randy Williams, and Mike Shea.
Good morning. I'm Patricia Mathis. I live in Annapolis, and I'm a retired teacher. I'm here today to ask you to speak out against the construction of a cell tower at Shadyside Elementary. The International Agency for Research on Cancer classified RF radiation as a possible human carcinogen in 2011. Since then, the National Toxicology Program study found exposure to wireless radiation increased the prevalence of malignant heart and brain cancers in rodents. And so, in 2016, the American Academy of Pediatrics issued recommendations to reduce cell phone exposures. Just recently, Maryland became the first state to respond to the new U.S. study linking wireless radiation to cancer. The Maryland State Children's Environmental Health and Protection Advisory Council issued recommendations to reduce radio frequency radiation to students in classrooms to as low as reasonably possible. The council cited the recent U.S. National Toxicology Program findings of increased malign cancers in animals, as well as children's unique vulnerability to the radiation. While several countries already have such protective measures, Maryland is the first state to have a state body issue protective recommendations. So why is this school board not responding to the Maryland Children's Environmental Health and Protection Council's call to reduce RF exposure to children in schools? Instead, you're adding more by endorsing a tower near the playground. Isn't it the job of the school board to consider the issues brought before it? Aren't you supposed to help us fix the problems? Instead, when we talk about this issue, you just say we don't agree. How could you not at least consider the possibility that you might be making a mistake in the face of all of the studies and organizations who are citing the dangers and risks? In November 2014, in a unanimous decision, the mayor and city council of Greenbelt, Maryland, sent a letter to Prince George's County Administration opposing the construction of cell towers on school properties in the city. The mayor said it's basically a way of raising money, and that's not the way to raise money. Cell phone company, there could be a serious financial risk to putting up a tower on school grounds. What liability insurance does the board and department have? Cell phone companies are informing their shareholders that there's a financial risk due to health issues. One example, Crown Castle Company wrote in the 2016 annual report to its shareholders, quote, the potential connection between our radio frequency emissions and certain negative health effects, including some forms of cancer, has been the subject of substantial study by the scientific community in recent years. We cannot guarantee that claims relating to RF emissions will not arise in the future, or that the results of such studies will not be adverse to us, end quote. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Mathis.
Oh, yeah. A little juggling act here.
Thanks. Okay, I don't have to do anything, huh? Okay. My name's Priscilla Smith from Shadyside. My family, neighbors, and I have been coming here for the past few months speaking out against the proposed cell tower at Shadyside Elementary School, and we've presented numerous current medical studies and clear community opposition. I'm here again because, unfortunately, this board has yet to do anything to help us, and the decision is still in your hands. Your response to our concerns so far have been that you don't share our concerns. On the other hand, you actually have a full-time employee dedicated to helping Milestone put towers on school grounds. Who do you work for, Milestone or the public? The American Academy of Pediatrics has changed their official recommendations for RF exposure. On their website, they recommend that the U.S. government tighten wireless exposure limits and that the public reduce children's exposure to cell phone tower radiation. The American Academy of Pediatrics states that children are not little adults, and they're disproportionately impacted by all environmental exposures, including RF radiation. They continue to state that current FCC standards do not account for the unique vulnerability specific to children, and that it is essential that any new standard should be based on protecting the youngest and most vulnerable populations
to ensure that they are safeguarded throughout their lifetimes. In fact, our very own Maryland State Advisory Council on Children's Environmental Health and Protection issued recommendations to reduce radio frequency radiation to students in classrooms to as low as reasonably possible. But as you can see, school districts are not acting on these expert public health recommendations. Why not? If you do not share my concerns, then you are also saying that you do not share the concerns of the American Academy of Pediatrics or the Maryland State Advisory Council on Children's Environmental Health and Protection. Putting a cell tower on school grounds directly violates the mission of your board to protect children and violates the trust of the children you're working for. In no way can you comply with the clear recommendations of the American Academy of Pediatrics to reduce children's RF exposure and continue to put cell towers on school grounds in Maryland. I'm asking you to reevaluate and cancel those deals you have with Milestone and Len Forkas and stop putting cell towers on school grounds in Maryland, please. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Smith.
My name is Pilot Earl Smith and I live in Shadyside. I want to know why you are putting cell towers at schools. I live right next to Shadyside Elementary School. I am a kid that will be forced to live under a cell tower. Nobody asked me if that was okay. If medical doctors are telling you to reduce radiation for children, then why are you not listening? Living next to a school should be the safest place to grow up. What are you doing to help me?
Thank you, Pilot.
Hi, I'm Randy Williams, and I just gave you a handout of a letter from a doctor, Martha Herbert. Dr. Martha Herbert is a pediatric neurologist and a neuroscientist. She's at the Massachusetts General Hospital and on the faculty of the Harvard School of Medicine. She wrote a paper to review literature looking for a potential link between electromagnetic frequencies and autism spectrum disorders. In a letter to the Los Angeles Unified School District in 2013, she wrote the following, and that's all in the paper. I'm just giving you some quotes. There are thousands of papers that have accumulated over decades and are now accumulating at an increased accelerated pace. As our ability to measure impact becomes more sensitive. That document, adverse health and neurological impacts of EMF. EMF from wireless, Wi-Fi, and cell towers can exert a disorganizing effect on the ability to learn and remember, and can also be destabilizing to the immune and metabolic functions. Those were her quotes that are in the letter that I gave you. So please review this letter. She said she stated 550 citations of studies that were done in her document. She wrote a 60-page document reviewing the cases. But please review this because this basically tells us that there is absolute, definite scientific studies out there that tell us that cell towers are not safe, and increasing the wireless capacity of our classrooms is extremely dangerous. And while we're looking at that, I know they're putting the addition onto Shadyside Elementary School, and since I'm on the PTO and I really care about the children, maybe we can just look at hardwiring those classes and not adding any more Wi-Fi to a school that doesn't need it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. Williams.
Mike Shea, and I'd like to speak to the process and transparency. The senior manager of the school system would know the process and would know that he was not accurate when he promised our community an up or down vote this last September. The senior manager of your planning knew that our written questions for Milestone were never answered, even after he repeatedly asked Milestone for them to answer our written questions. The senior manager of planning knew Milestone's required public meeting account was not accurate and a representation of what happened. He was there. It was billed as a community informational meeting, and still the community's questions are not answered. These are the exact reasons Prince George's County dismissed Milestone from doing business in Prince George's County. But for our Anne Arundel County School Board, this is business as usual. You've aligned yourself with Milestone, a company that's thrown out of Prince George's County for reasons that you continue to ignore and defend. The majority of the Anne Arundel County School Board is on the wrong side of safety for our children, the wrong side of history, the wrong side of process, and the wrong side of transparency. You've overworked, you've overreached the system on behalf of Milestone for no direct benefit to students, and by most educated accounts, endangered their health. You've also dodged accountability by not voting in front of the public. I'd like to give you an update on our community and parents being locked out of the PTO and now closed out. Some of the Anne Arundel County School Board Administration has claimed independence from the PTO. There is plenty of written and implied relationship that exists. We've talked in the past about the lockout of our parents with the assistance of the school board, the school principal in Shadyside. I will share with you that the locked out has now turned to closed out. The executive board of the PTO voted unanimously to disregard the request of 12 new members to create a standing committee on health and safety. The principal is a member of the executive committee. This was an important and reasonable request by the parents that wish to focus and work on the most important issue for our children. Parents expect and assume this issue of health and safety is being addressed by the PTO, and it is not. It is being shunned.
Thank you, Mr. Shea. CJ Mushaw and Kina Armagast. Am I saying that correctly? Is it Kina? Kina, I didn't.
No.
Is it Kina? It is Kina. Okay, thank you.
Go ahead and start. Okay, great. Thank you so much for having me here today. My name is CJ Mushaw, and I live in Mayo, Maryland. I'm here to talk about the cyberbullying and physical bullying taking place at Southern, just as a community member and advocate of equality. There has been quite a lot of violence going on, and a number of folks from the community have spoken up and reached out and offered support to the school, to the county council, and now to the school board. And we're really happy to have your ear. The Gay Straight Alliance at Southern High School has also spoken up and asked for the opportunity to speak before the student body and humanize some of the aspects that other students may have trouble relating to or not have a lot of exposure to. Unfortunately, that request, a pretty simple request, was denied. And I don't want to single out Southern because we're all a community and nobody should be left alone in this, either the school or the board or the actual individuals targeted or doing the targeting. This is something we work on as a unit. The students targeted and the students who are doing the targeting are really voicing a need for our guidance as a community. At a minimum, some basic anti-bullying education would be a wonderful way to start. Really a wonderful way to start, and there's a lot of resources available to us.
After Crofton Elementary School experienced a traumatizing hate crime incident at their school, the community, government, and local churches, student body, everybody came together in a show of loving kindness for the students in school and folks that use the facilities. From that effort, Kindness Grows Here, a nonprofit, has been developed and also offers some really amazing anti-bullying workshops in the community. The principal at Crofton is having that workshop take place at the school. The workshop was developed based on extensive social service and experience supporting youth and young adult psychology and wellness, and I think it would be a great place for Southern to start as well, and something easy that they could kind of take advantage of that's already going on in the community. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Mitchell.
Hi, my name is Keena Arbogast. You heard from my husband, Jimmy, previously. My son is Ryan. He is a transgender student at Southern High School. He's been a victim of both in-person bullying, cyberbullying, physical threats, among other things, unfortunately, in our community. I'm here today to ask you guys to step up both the guidelines on transgender students as, one, they are not sufficient. They do not meet the needs of the students. And also to ask that their implementation be completed. Unfortunately, many of the staff members we have come across are both not aware of the guidelines participatively existing, and the ones who are aware that they exist don't know either what they say, what they mean, or how to actually execute what they say. From a safety standpoint, and my understanding of the guidelines, there's really not anything in there that protects these LGBTQ students. Although, sorry, train of thought. I know that our students fall under Title IX, and I don't see anything written in the guidelines that refers to that. I know that's something important that historically has protected, you know, children on sex discrimination. However, I don't see in the guidelines anything referred to that. Oh, the things I sent you. Thank you. So that's my pull at Title IX. As far as the staff, the guidelines, the staff needs training. As far as LGBT concerns, as far as what their students are experiencing, what it means to be that student, and what they experience in their school environment, what their needs are from the teachers, from the staff, from a safety standpoint, is my biggest concern right now, is that these students are not being protected, you know, again, because the staff, the teachers don't understand the guidelines, and also because the guidelines do not have safety, you know, safety codes written within them. Safety zones, one of the things for that should be in the guidelines, which some schools such as Arundel High School have, is something called safety zones, which for any student is a place where they can go and they can be removed from a bullying situation, regardless of the reason for the bullying. Yeah, I think that covers that. As far as the training for that, as my husband said earlier, there's wonderful resources within the community, one of them being PFLAG, another one being GLSEN. So if you could take the time and help us get those resources and that training in order to keep all of our children safe. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Arbogast. Is there any other public comment? Okay. To item 4.01, which is an information to action item. Do I have a motion to move this from information to action?
So moved.
All those in favor? Dr. Arlotto, your recommendation.
Yes, ma'am. I recommend that the Board of Education approve the contract for professional engineering, design, and construction administration services for the parking lot and bus loop expansion at Arundel Middle School.
Second.
Are there any board questions or comments? Any public comment? All those in favor? Motion passes. Okay. Item 5.00 is the 2017-2018 Board of Education meeting dates. Mr. Gilliland.
Thank you, Madam President. I move that the Board of Education general session on January 24th, 2018, scheduled for 10 a.m., be changed to an evening meeting beginning at 7 p.m.
Second. Are there any board comments? Ms. Korbelak.
My only concern with switching it today, I know that I personally can't be here at that evening meeting. I can be here for the day meeting, and Mr. Reinhart and Mr. Granin aren't here to weigh in. So if by chance they're not available either, we would be down to a five-person meeting, which means everybody would have to vote in unanimously for anything that we're trying to pass. I understand we won't have our newest board member until February, so that's my only concern about the switch.
Ms. Sasa.
I don't have any concern about the switch, but I want the public to basically know that the consideration of the board to change it to an evening meeting is because most of it is budget, and even though it has been public already that the budget has discussed, at that meeting we would be making some type of decision so that they are...
No, actually it's not. It will not be, it's not the budget meeting. We will, prior to that, in the 2 weeks prior to that, we will have two public budget hearings and a public budget workshop, but the January 24th meeting will not be to vote on the budget. We simply would like to move it to an evening meeting because we try each month to have a day meeting and evening meeting to reach more people. And the earlier meeting of the month is a day meeting. So this would be for that. So it would not be a budget meeting. There will be other business going on, but we won't be voting on the budget that night.
Okay.
Any other comments? All right. All those in favor? Opposed? Okay. Motion passes 5-1. Item 5.01 is administrative personnel appointments. Dr. Arlotto, your recommendation.
Yes, ma'am. I recommend that the personnel listed on the attached sheets be promoted and or appointed.
So moved.
Second. Okay. Are there any questions or comments? Okay. All those in favor? Motion passes 6-0. Item 5.02 is personnel. Dr. Arlotto, your recommendation?
Yes, ma'am. I recommend that the board approve the actions as stipulated on the attached sheets.
So moved. Second.
Okay. Are there any board questions or comments? All those in favor? Motion passes 6-0. Item 5.03 is an information item, policy, and we have a lot of policy today. Go for it, Ms. Ortiz.
Good morning. Second readings. Good morning. For the record, Jeanette Ortiz, Legislative and Policy Council. So we have item 5.03 is board membership, policy BAA. It's on second reading. I did want to point out that at the last, when this policy was on first reading, it was requested that I insert sunset language to make it clear that after a certain date, different provisions of the policy would go into effect without the board having to take action. And just to give a little bit of background on that, BAA is being amended as a result of new state law, which will ultimately create a fully elected school board. So that has caused us to have to update some of our board policies, and this one on board membership. So you will see on the bottom of the first page here, under position item 2, I added, it's similar to what the General Assembly does with sunset language. I had to tweak it a little bit. Which basically says that the policy language will remain effective until December 2nd, 2018. And then at the end of that, with no further action by the board, the new policy language will take effect, and that follows on the second page.
On the second page where it says the composition of the board shall change beginning December 3rd, at such time the board will move toward a composition so that
of 7 nonpartisan elected members, that will move forward language, because it won't be a full elected board as of December 3rd,
exactly.
2013. So that move toward encompasses
exactly
that.
And so I was trying to word that in the way, even though the law says we now have a fully elected school board, you know, as of June 1st when it went into effect, that's not technically accurate because the first elections are in 2018, and then we will have 3 more elections in 2022. So it's not until 2022 that we will truly have a fully elected school board. So I put that language moving towards a fully elected school board just to kind of address that some will be elected, but some will still have been in their appointed positions.
Are there any other board questions or comments? And this is the second reading, and this will come before us for vote the next meeting?
Yes, correct.
All right. All right. Item 5.04.
So policy BAB, board powers and duties, again, was this was not affected as far as having to do any sunset language. And the change here was some stylistic changes, but specifically under position, there was reference to the education article of the Maryland Code. However, because we're now moving towards an elected school board, we are also under the election article. So I just put in accordance with state law just to be accurate. But that's in effect once it goes. There's no future effective date on this particular policy.
Are there any board questions or comments? Any public comment? Okay, this one will be coming back to us next month.
Yes.
Next meeting.
Correct.
Item 5.05.
So policy BB, appointment qualifications and term of office. This is similar to BAA in that some provisions take effect now once the board finalizes and approves the policy changes, and then other provisions will take effect December 2nd, 2018. So if you see on page 3 of 7 of the policy at the bottom, item 5, I inserted the same sunset language that I inserted in policy BAA.
Are there any board questions or comments? Any public comment? We'll see this back for third reading.
Yes,
in the next
correct.
Meeting.
The
item 5.06.
This is policy BFA, board policy dissemination. I don't have to make any additional changes to this one. So again, it's just updating how we disseminate our policies and regulations to the public.
Okay. Any board questions or comments? Any public comments? Okay. See it back here next meeting?
Yes, correct.
Item 5.07.
So this is a student fundraising. Make sure I have the right one in front of me. Yep, student fundraising policy KE. And this was just updating policy that was very dated and just reorganizing it and updating it to current practices.
Are there any board questions or comments? Any public comment? And so far, none of these have received any public comment when posted online.
That is correct, yes.
Okay. All right, we'll see this one back next meeting.
Next meeting, yes, thank you.
Item 5.08.
So this is DJ, funding proposals, grants, and special requests. You may recall at the last meeting, on first reading, I explained that we have currently 4 different standalone policies dealing with substantially similar things. So a group of us met to determine the most efficient way to have this information out there for the public. And so policies DJA, DJB, and DJC were consolidated into a new policy DJ, and the accompanying regulations were consolidated into the DJRA regulation.
Are there any board questions or comments? Any public comment? Okay, we'll see it back next meeting. Item 5.09.
Okay, so this is policy KD, visitors to the schools. I know there were some questions and clarifications that were requested of this policy on first reading. So you will note
under the purpose on page one of the policy, I inserted language to make it clear that we are dealing with school visitors during the school day. I also included or other bona fide school activities. That is language that is used in the education article and state law. I know there was a concern expressed of, you know, what if it's an activity that's happening outside of the normal school day? So that, I think, will encompass everything we need it to and makes it clear this is for school, regular school functions. And those were the, that was the only, I did the same for the regulation as well, my apologies. On the purpose of page one of the regulation, I inserted the same language just to clarify that.
Okay. Are there any questions or comments on this policy? Any public comment? All right.
There was
one. Oh, wait, I'm sorry, Ms. Sasso. Oh,
yeah. I want to go back to the word shall. Was it basically pinpointed anywhere that for us shall is must?
Yeah, so I spoke to Tyson about this, and I know that the board has discussed, you know, what terms should be used to indicate that something is required. And so what was determined prior to my arriving at AACPS and what is consistent with state law drafting is that shall is a must and a requirement. There are instances in state law which must is used if it's something like you must be sort of for the election, the school board, the new elected school board, you must be a resident of Anne Arundel County to run for, you know, the elected school board. But other than that, it's very limited when the state uses must. Shall is what is used, and may is just optional, and may not is really shall not. So that's so I did speak to Tyson about that at, per your request, Ms. Sasso, and he did agree that we are using the proper language, and we've been consistent throughout our policies and regulations. And in the older policies and regulations that I come across where shall is not being used, I've updated it so that we are consistent, because we don't want inconsistencies, as that could create questions as to our true intent.
So it is known that our intent for shall is a must. It's a requirement.
Yes. Okay. Yes. And that is used in state law and regulation drafting as well. And state law, I actually created my own little drafting manual to help me draft. And I've put that in there, the definition of what shall is. Yeah. And then the state has a drafting manual, and it explicitly states what shall means, what may means, and what must means.
Thank you.
You're welcome. And I just wanted to say there was one public comment on KD, and it was just someone, I believe it was either a reading specialist or one of the school staff, just asking about the provision in the regulation where it states that, you know, on page 2 of 3, item 6, that parents who wish to create an audio recording of a meeting with school personnel would have to request permission of the school principal. And she was just asking for clarification of that, and I was able to answer her question. She was satisfied with my answers.
All right, we'll see this one back
at the next meeting. Yes,
thank you.
All right, item 5.10.
So this takes us back to, these are rescinding of policies, and they relate to policy DJ. And as we've done in the past, you may recall, we did it with materials of instruction over the summer, policy IH, where because we were consolidating policies and regulations into one new policy and regulation, the other policies that have now been sort of transferred over are no longer needed. So once the board approves a final version of policy DJ, at that time, I would ask that you also vote to rescind policies DJA, DJB, and DJC, as they will be incorporated into policy DJ.
Are there any board questions or comments?
None.
Any public comment? All right, we'll see that one back on the 20th.
Yes.
Item 5.11.
Okay, so we have policy IIH, quarterly assessments. The Division of Curriculum Instruction, Office of School Performance, Division of Advanced Studies and Programs and Instructional Data Division are bringing policy IIH quarterly assessments before you for first reading. This policy was last revised on November 4th, 2015. The updated policy removes the language regarding waiver of the quarterly assessment in the fourth marking period and keeps this process in the regulation where it truly belongs. The regulation has been updated to allow only seniors who are in AP or IB courses to take an AP or IB exam the option to waive the quarterly assessment in the fourth marking period. This change would take effect in the 2018-2019 school year. The policy will be posted on our website for 30 days for public comment, and we can answer any questions you may have.
Mr. Gilliland.
Thank you. My question is not necessarily about the changes for the policy, but just within the policy, and I know it's in the reg as well, the comment about superintendent's designee allows the farm students to not have to pay for AP or IB exams. Is there a way that that's done, you know, with some discretion or you know, something that's discreet so that it's not widely known, you know, so that students can do that without fear of others knowing?
So I think Michelle Batten can answer that for you.
Yes, the answer is yes. That is done discreetly through the counselor's office and the administrators.
Are there any other questions or comments? Any public comment? All right, so we'll see this one back in
after the 30-day public
after the 30-day period. And that was a lot for you today, but that
so
does it for the policies.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. All right. Item 5.12 is an action item, Maryland Open Meetings Act trainee designation. Mr. Gilliland.
Thank you, Madam President. I move that the board name Julie Hummer, Stacy Korbelak, and Colin Reinhardt as official Maryland Open Meeting Act designees of the Board of Education of Anne Arundel County.
Second.
Are there any board comments on this? This is a new provision of the law, and once board members have received training, they can then be designated as the designee, and Ms. Korbelak, Mr. Reinhardt, and I all completed the training, so that's why. It is now coming before you, and so all those in favor? Motion passes.
6-5. Dr. Arlotto, you're at
oh, sorry, my mic was off. Dr. Arlotto, your recommendation.
Yes, ma'am. I recommend board approval of these courses beginning with the 2017-2018 school year.
All right, and I believe that we do not have a. So, are there any board questions or comments regarding these new courses? Okay. Any public comments? All right. All those in favor? All right, motion passes 6-0. Okay, item 5.14 is an information action item. Do I have a motion to move this from information to action?
Second.
Dr. Arlotto, your recommendation.
Yes, ma'am. I recommend board approval of the Brockbridge Elementary School deed and deed of easement.
Second.
All right. And are there any board questions or comments? Well, I'll have one. This is just in a little sliver of the corner of the property. Is that correct?
Yes, ma'am. For the record, Alex Shacknose, Chief Operating Officer. One of the slivers is so little, it's 0.012 acres, I believe. So it's a corner. It's a street corner.
Is there any public comment? So all those in favor? Motion passes 6-0. All right. Item 5.15. is the superintendent's recommendations on redistricting. This is an information item, and we have a Do I do your recommendation first? Or we have a presentation first? We have a presentation.
Good morning, President Hummer, Vice President Gillian, members of the board, and Dr. Arlotto. For the record, I'm Lisa Seaman Crawford, Director of Facilities. And with me is Greg Stewart, Senior Manager of Planning, and Alex Sheknovich. In accordance with Board Policy JAA and Regulation JAA-RA, the superintendent is required to submit to the board his recommendation for redistricting no later than the first board meeting in December. The board will review the superintendent's recommendation along with any board member proposal, and by the end of January, determine which option or options will go forward to a public hearing. At the board meeting following the public hearing, but no later than April 30th, the board shall make an announcement, announce its decision in public session. There are two redistricting proposals in your packet. The first is an option to alleviate projected overcrowding at MacArthur Middle School due to continued enrollment growth. This option is proposed to go into effect in the 2018-2019 school year. The second proposal is following the completion of George Cromwell Elementary School renovation and addition, moving the kindergarten students currently attending Ferndale Early Education Center back to George Cromwell Elementary. George Cromwell will return to a K through 5 facility. Pre-K students at Hilltop would then be reassigned to Ferndale Early Education Center, relieving the overcrowded at Hilltop Elementary School. And this proposal will go into effect for the 2020 and 2021 school year. And Mr. Stewart will provide a little more details on the proposals before you.
Good morning, Greg Stewart, for the record. If you turn to the beginning of the packet, you'll see two colored maps. That is the current middle school boundaries for Meade Middle and MacArthur. And Maryland City, the catchment area for the Maryland City Elementary School, currently goes to MacArthur Middle. And what we're trying to do is basically unify that area. If you look on Exhibit 2, it basically makes that area of the Maryland City community as one to all go to one middle school. So we're basically balancing it from the enrollment projections, and we're also geographically making the whole place unified. So that's the general redistricting. It's, again, the Maryland City entire catchment area into from MacArthur to Meade Middle. There are two other pieces in that. There is a grandfathering option for those rising seventh graders. They would be given the option to remain at MacArthur Middle if they choose. And the second part of that is the, because MacArthur is a IB program, middle years, those students that are currently enrolled as a sixth grader in that program, they would be given preference to continue in that system. And that's the other recommendation for this. And again, there's summary. You'll see the committee's recommendation. Also, I'd like to thank the committee. They did, you know, a lot of work in the two different meetings that we had, and also my staff, Scott Schuler and Mark Lucas, helped them put together some of the exhibits and background for it. The other redistricting is the, if we flip forward a little bit, is the Ferndale, it's actually three schools involved, is the Ferndale Early Education Center, and as Lisa mentioned, moving the once George Cromwell, which is currently under construction, is to move those students back in the 2020 school year. And once we do that, we'll actually be able to programmatically move the pre-K students from Hilltop down to Ferndale, which helps Hilltop out. And the other part of this, there is a small area at the, if you look at the map, kind of back in the in your packet, you'll see a map. There's a small area in the bottom that currently it represents nine students, and those students actually walk to George Cromwell, but in order to walk there, they walk through the Hilltop attendance zone, then have to cross over the overpass of 97 to get there. And the idea is to incorporate that into the Hilltop district, and that way it would be all inclusive. Our transportation division has gone out to the site. There is a crossing guard that goes over Wellam Avenue, and they felt it was a safe route to school, and it would improve that situation. Those students that are living there, there is also a provision for a grandfathering for those rising fourth graders. And the only difference, again, if you read the committee's recommendation, we have a slightly different recommendation than they had. They were saying all the people that currently live in those homes would continue to go to George Cromwell, but if somebody moved in, a new family moved in, or somebody who just started school, they would actually have to go to Hilltop, and we didn't think that was an appropriate. We thought if we're going to redistrict, we need to move them all at the same time. And with that, we'll take any questions you might have.
Mr. Gilliland.
Thank you, Madam President, and thank you for this. In broad terms, I like what I see. I just had a couple of questions that I think are within the scope or our charge with this, but hopefully the clarification will help. And this page isn't numbered, but it's, I guess we'll call it Exhibit 1 within the Ferndale Cromwell Hilltop packet, the color map. And this little patch of blue, the overlook area that's within the Hilltop boundaries. I'm just from a logistical perspective, and again, I know that's not necessarily within today's charge, but can't we do something better with that? I just feel like the buses are, you know, going all the way over here and then going all the way back over there, whereas you know, we've got North Glen that appears, at least on the map, to be a stone's throw, and then certainly, you know, it's within the Hilltop area, adjacent to the North Glen area, and Overlook is just way the heck over there. So I guess just getting some clarification on that.
Certainly, Alex Shackno, Chief Operating Officer. So we're going to take a more comprehensive approach to that. We've got the Richard Henry Lee School that you can see just at the bottom element of that page, and some other capital improvements that are in the works or contemplated. So the charge of this committee specifically was with respect to our capital improvement program at Cromwell, but we're going to peel that onion layer back a little bit further and take a look at the entire area. As you know, that when we are going about the process also of establishing the old mill areas, once we begin bifurcating those areas into, that's going to create a lot of domino effects. So you are correct, there's a lot of sort of historical cleanup that has to occur, but it's a little bit of a right time, right place, and I think we have a plan to address that and many other these small little technical anomalies or adjustments that have sort of manifested themselves over the years.
And then the second part, just to Hilltop in particular, and again, I the numbers that are here certainly are trending in the right direction, but I just think of Hilltop, and you know, certainly from, you know, the conversations I've had with the prior principal, I don't know the current principal there, at least have not met with her since she moved from North Glen, but I just think of, you know, yes, we're within we're below capacity, we're at 93.2% projected in 2022, but then 630 students at Hilltop Elementary is still a lot of students at that school in particular, and I'm just hoping that if there's a way some shifting can occur as part of a broader conversation later, that's going to alleviate Hilltop. And
we fully intend to do exactly that.
Awesome. Thank you.
All right. Are there any other questions, board questions or comments? So are there any public comments? All right. So the board will review this recommendation and along with any board member proposals and determine no later than the end of January which option will go forward to a public hearing on redistricting. So thank you for all your work on this. Well done. Item 5.16 is the 2017 to 2022 strategic plan. This is an information to action item. Do I have a motion to move this from information to action?
Second.
Okay. All those in favor? Okay. Dr. Arlotto, your recommendation.
Yes, ma'am. I recommend that the board approve our strategic plan for Anne Arundel County Public Schools for 2017 to 2022.
Okay. Do I have a second?
Second.
Okay, and we have a presentation.
It's a very short presentation. For the record, my name is Maureen McMahon. I'm the Deputy Superintendent for Academics and Strategic Initiatives, and I'd like to ask my colleagues to introduce themselves.
Hello, Monique Jackson, Deputy Superintendent for Student and School Support.
Good morning, Jason Dykstra, Executive Director of Instructional Data.
So as you know, for approximately the last 18 months, we've been working on the plan with our internal stakeholders and our community at large. So at this point in time, we had the plan open for 2 weeks, and we received 56 public comments over the two-week period of time, approximately 40% of which came from internal stakeholders and 60% from outside stakeholders. We took all of the comments that we received, and we read them multiple times, and the plan has been changed to in multiple places to add detail, to answer some ambiguities that were brought up, and it's more robust at this time. One of the biggest things that was brought up by multiple stakeholders was, in some ways, what happens next, right? In other words, they brought up the notion of where are we going? How do we do the next steps? Although that was asked many different ways, that was really a piece of it. And you'll see now on many pieces of the plan where we talk about a strategic plan toolkit for both our schools and our offices. And that was always in the plan. It can't be built until after the plan is approved. But the notion is we recognize that schools and offices are going to need support with the plan. And so that will end up having to live on this website as well to support all the stakeholders in achieving what's presented here. So with that, I know my colleagues and I will take any questions you may have.
Ms. Sasso.
I basically read all of the comments, and it really surprised me how many negative comments are in here. You said you have revised the plan, and personally today, if we're going to take a vote, I will vote no, because I would like to see all of the revised things that have happened, because after reading it, I mean, I underlined yellow after yellow what was negative, and I would like to see what was revised to basically take into consideration what was discussed in the negative.
Ms. Korblak.
I had some questions, more like a wordsmithing. I had my English professor hat on, and as we've talked, less is more sometimes. So I'm wondering, we have these five values, and to me, four of them could be condensed down to two. So I'm just trying to understand why they were split into five. From the way I read the values, value number two, all means all, is the value. And that including in that is that we value diversity, we want to nurture it, we want to celebrate it, but we also want to make sure everybody feels welcome. So I'm wondering if we can have one value that's essentially all means all and explain it with the text that's in value one and two. Then my second thing I see is that our second value is that we want to make sure our students are prepared for college, career, and community. How we go about doing that is part of value four. Obviously, we're going to do it in the classroom, but we also want to do it outside the classroom. So can we combine those two into one value that we value preparing students for college, career, and community? And then value five is fine. That's the community engagement piece. That's totally get that. The value that I feel like is missing from here is more on the corporate side, which I know that stakeholders aren't always thinking about. We're all talking about people and the touchy-feely stuff, but we're a billion-dollar corporation, and I think we value here at AACPS running it efficiently. Like, I think that's a value of our school system, and I think we do it well. Not everybody agrees, but I'd like to see that as a value, that we value having an efficiently run corporation, essentially. You know, efficient use of our resources, our times, our talents, our treasures. So that's sort of where the kind of revisions I would like to see if we're going to revise anything. I think everything's here, and I think it's great. I just wonder if we can sort of condense it down.
Dr. Arlotto.
Certainly, I know there are other board comments, but I'll just jump in at this point. I think the values that stand before you that have been published up to this point are a direct result of all of the community input, so both internal and external. And it was made very clear by our stakeholders that these were important values. We did discuss internally, should we combine? So your suggestion is certainly one that we talked about, but we thought it was most important to have them separated. That there is, we want to make sure that diversity is not lost, among other things, the all means all, and that making sure people are welcome, this really rose to the top. This was something that was very important to our stakeholders, and this is 18 months worth of work. We were out doing, as you well know, and you as a board participated yourself in workshops, in our forums at the high schools, in surveys and the like. And so we felt it was important as a team that these five, that the community see the values that they brought forward and discussed. So if the board wants to combine those, we certainly can do that. It's in the end, it's your plan. But if that's the direction of this board, then I'm going to suggest that we not vote on this today and you give us time. We're going to need more feedback. This is the appropriate forum to do it publicly. I would say it's not time to vote on it if the board wants to make some changes. But we felt strongly that coming from the public, these values are what rose to the top. And I want to be very clear that the public sees what they discussed in the plan, that it's not hidden, and certainly something like diversity, I don't want undermined, as important as it is, to be woven into something else. I want it to be a very clear and distinct piece of what we're doing, because it's elevating all of our students and eliminating all of our gaps. That's our key. The interesting thing, business, I think it's something we do well. I appreciate that comment. I think it's something we do well as a school system. We manage over $1 billion budget. And I think we're well-recognized internal practices that are recognized each and every year through Matt Stansky and his team, by state and national groups, of our ability to manage our budgets. This was not something that rose up to the top of one of the values. And it may be because our stakeholders see that we do it well. Maybe that's the reason it didn't. But again, if the board wants us to include something so that there are some data points that we can follow and celebrate, if you will, I think that's what I'm hearing, Mrs. Korbelak. Again, that's something we can incorporate, but again, I would say give us time, then this is not the day to vote on it if this is what the board wants to move, and it will be your discussion, again, here publicly. We're glad to move forward with that and have some discussions and get some more input, but then today would not be the day to make that vote.
Ms. Sasso.
Yes, I would like to ask the committee, basically, since you have stated that you have basically taken into consideration some of the things that they requested, you know, as you incorporate those, if you would just, because they are major areas that they have touched and commented on negatively, if when you include that, you know, you say, tell us back, you know, because of these comments, we have addressed them and we are solving them this way. I want the public, when they made the comment, to feel that we answered their comment by doing this.
Well, I'll say the comments, I think, what was the total number?
56.
Yeah. And keeping in mind that 56, and you say the majority of them are negative, we had hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people involved in this. It was very important to me and to this team that this was out publicly. And this was going to be a strategic plan built by this board and the public we serve. And so I think it speaks volumes that while many of them may have been negative in that comment, mm-hmm. we had hundreds and hundreds of people that submitted, and they see this plan. They see what their comments were in this plan. There will be some negative comments, I assure you, that we're not going to be able to address and that we will not move forward with. And I don't think the board would support that either. So I don't know that we're going to be able to address every single one of them to the satisfaction of people. We will certainly rest assured, Mrs. Sasso and members of the board, we will consider them and look at them. But I don't believe that every negative comment or suggestion we'll be able to incorporate into our plan.
That's why I said they're in general areas. So that
I just want to clarify, because you had said about could we then suffice it for them, and we will not be able to satisfy everybody.
No, I agree.
Okay,
we can't satisfy
sure
everybody,
clear.
But in general areas, like you pinpointed, you know, whatever it happens to be, teachers was one of them, you know, so you address it, you know, it was solved by putting this here. Thank you, Dr. Lutz.
early January or mid-January? Would you say mid-January? End of January. Okay. Second meeting in January. Okay.
Stacy won't be here.
Oh, shoot.
All right. Mr. Gilliland.
Thank you, Madam President. In a moment, I'm going to make a motion, but just a couple of comments to start. And first, I agree with Mrs. Korbelak. I think in your English hat, you were saying word consolidation. I don't want to twist your words. In economics, we call it efficiency. So we're in the same spot. But I also agree wholeheartedly with her about the business component to the strategic plan, because while I do think we do a great job, you know, there's always room for improvement, and I do believe in showcasing the greatness that exists here, and certainly that business and operational component is a true testament to the leadership, not just of Dr. Arlotto, but I think Mr. Shaknovich and his entire team. And where we can showcase the good and look at the ways to change, I'll quote a former superintendent who noted the book Good to Great, you know, the Collins book quite often. And I think as we move from great to whatever is beyond great, I think it's just good to have that there for a couple of reasons. And I do think that as we have a new high school on the horizon and then an additional high school on the further horizon over the next decade, there's going to be a lot of money that this board will be accountable to the public on managing well. And with that accountability of the board, certainly there's the accountability to the superintendent and then obviously the accountability to the senior staff. As we look at the Old Mill project, it's no secret, and I'll say the B word, but I mean, we're looking at a $1 billion project. I think when we consider what is all entailed there, high schools on down, $1 billion, and that's a huge undertaking. And so when I think we look at this 5-year plan, we're staging, I think, the biggest growth that this school system has seen on the capital budget side in decades. So I think there's room to have that value added. So I do thank Mrs. Korbelak for that. One question I was going to ask, and you know, maybe this is just semantics, but I certainly trust your judgment. The strategic plan, should it remain 2017-2022, or should it be 2018-2023?
Well, that was going to that was something I was going to bring up. if we are not going to, if the board is not going to vote today, and you're going to push this into January, February, whenever you want us to come back and continue this conversation, if we've done some work, our current plan will have sunsetted at the end of December. So what I would suggest is that the board, after your conversation is finished, that someone make a motion for us to continue to operate under the current strategic plan until a new strategic plan is adopted, if that makes sense, in whatever words you choose.
I'll make two motions then. Yeah. Right. So, Madam President, if I may, two motions. One is that we table the vote on the strategic plan until the first meeting in January.
Don't we need to ask for public comment at some point?
Or public comment?
Yes. If we can talk a little bit about that first meeting in January, I don't know if that's going to give us much time. We're going to be going into the winter break, and I'm going to want to make sure that any language changes or additions or major changes, I guess, that we're sharing with the public and we're getting it out there. So I would, if that makes sense, I think we're going into the winter break, and I'm not sure people will be available.
Can it be done by December 19th? Can the changes be done?
I don't believe so, no matter.
And we also are having budget presentation at that time, and we don't want everything to get lost.
Okay. What about public comment. Is it okay to make Okay. So, Madam President, I move that we table this vote until the first meeting in February, which February 7th, 2018.
So moved. Second.
Okay. Are there any board comments on this motion? Is there any public comment on this motion?
Yes. My name is Victoria Calhoun. I'm here as a parent, but I am also the president of the Jessup Elementary School PTA. I have 30 years of military service, strategic planning, and the like. The term strategy is misapplied often, and it has been in this case. This so-called plan before you today is not a strategy document, but some sort of marketing ploy that has been to be levied on the citizens of this county and waste valuable educational time of the kids currently attending Anne Arundel County Public Schools. There is a tendency to use the term strategy as a general term for concepts or ideas of a direction in which to proceed, as was done in this case. But good strategies are the domain of senior leaders that use them to drive organizations to higher levels of achievement and outcomes, as Ms. Korblek and Ms. Sasso, excuse me if I mispronounce your names, have mentioned. This document, which was created for you, is really some sort of website. I had asked for a hard copy of the document, and it was not provided to me. This is the second meeting on this subject I have been to. The format of the meetings were horrible, and you have been horribly been misled in the conversations today about how those meetings were conducted and how the public was participation was solicited. This document that was, or this website that was created has no ends, no ways, no means to achieve the required goal that every child actually meet or exceed the necessary standards to be the best that they can be in their lives or chosen profession. Religious and philosophical teachings direct people to stay away from forward people, twisting words from their true meaning, and whose total intent is to deceive people, and their conduct is not straightforward in their dealings. I said I had asked for a copy of this plan. One was never, ever provided. This posting on this website was the first time public comment had been taken in any sort of written form. I had gone to the meetings, and I had actually provided some comments within the format of those meetings, which was terrible. I told you I'm standing here today as a parent that there are real issues that need to be addressed in this plan that were brought up to both this board many times and to the Kerwin Commission and that have not been addressed. I think your idea to table this issue is absolutely correct. I would like an opportunity to input my ideas to this plan in a collaborative website. Other parents had asked to be able to actually provide content to the plan, and I am willing to do that to help the community get ends, ways, and means to actually fill the gap. And I had provided documentation to the Kerwin Commission on how to address the budget issues. And so to the business end, I do believe there are ways to get after the major issues that we possess here today. And I do recommend that you table it and get real public input. Thank you.
Thank you. We've got to vote on the thing. So I do want to say I appreciate all the work and the input that has gone into this, and I think what you're hearing is the board just wants some more time to digest and give our feedback on this. So I'm in support of this motion as well. So if there's no further board comments, all those in favor of tabling the vote for this until February 7th? Okay, motion passes. Mr. Gilliland.
Thank you again, Madam President. Given that motion having passed, I now move to keep the current plan in effect until the vote occurs on the new plan.
So moved. Second.
Are there any board questions or comments on that motion? Any public comment? Okay, all those in favor? Okay, the current strategic plan will continue in place until February 7th. Thank you all very much.
This has been an incredible amount of work. Thank you.
So. Item 6.01 is a review item, award of contracts. Are there any board questions or comments on this item? Any public comment? Okay. I'm sorry, Ms. Sasso.
I just have a question. It has to do with the underground fuel storage tanks. Probably a question for Alex. Yeah. Alex, around how many underground tanks do we have? Just a guesstimate. And are they in compliance with the EPA? You know, they're not leaking. We don't have any problems with them.
Sure. Alex Shekno, Chief Operating Officer. So probably on the order of about half of our schools are serviced by underground fuel oil storage tanks, simply because the natural gas supply, the pipe natural gas supply in this county, does not reach many, many areas. So large swaths of this county don't even have the opportunity to have natural gas service be available. Where that opportunity exists, we'll continue to migrate in that manner. But as a result of that, we are left with the only option being these underground storage tanks. So the answer to your question directly is yes, and this is part of the contract that allows us. So they do have to have maintenance inspections that are done on them. Cathodic protection has to be reevaluated. The various components of it, the overspill buckets, the caps, et cetera, on them are inspected and maintained by us. And then Maryland Department of Environment also externally validates those tanks as well. So there's essentially three sets of eyes on them, our own staff set of eyes, our contractor set of eyes, and then the Maryland State Department of Environment sets of eyes on them.
And one of those tests, we test the ground underneath to make sure they're not leaking?
No, we do not test the ground underneath of the tank. There's other ways to identify whether the tank is leaking. The ground in and around the tank is tested in general once the tank is being removed out of service. So as part of the removal process, should a tank be replaced or should a tank be removed such that we can switch over to natural gas service at that time, that's when the ground is tested. But that is the way to test for a leak is not to dig underneath of the tank and test the soil. There's other methodologies that are used to do that.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
Any other board questions? All right, thank you, Mr. Shaknovich. All right, that concludes the agenda for today. The next Board of Education meeting is Wednesday, December 20th at 7 p.m. The next Board Policy Committee meeting is Wednesday, December 13th at 1 p.m. And the next Board Budget Committee meeting is Wednesday, December 20th at 5 p.m. And Mr. Gilliland.
Thank you, Madam President. I move that the board go into closed session to conduct collective bargaining negotiations or consider matters that relate to the negotiations.
Those in favor? Meeting is adjourned.